Welcome, everyone. We're delighted to see so many parents and professors and friends, staff members, mentors gather tonight. My name is Amy Forbes. I'm the Associate Director of the Centennial Center for Leadership. I'll be your host for the evening, which means I have some important introductions to outline the contest and then to make nice with our judging panel so this doesn't turn into an episode of Shark Tank. Most importantly, it's my job to see that we give each of these student entrepreneurs a chance to pitch their ideas that they have worked so hard on. Before I begin, I want to kindly remind our audience to put your phones on silent. We do welcome you to live tweet, though, throughout the event, as you can see the hashtag on the screen, which is ThePitch2013. I know. As many of you know, this is the second year of the Centennial Center for Leadership has organized and sponsored the pitch. Although last year will always be memorable as our inaugural year, this year's contest has been no less exciting. It's been a year of many firsts. We had our first year, Elena Zuzu, reach the second round. We had our first sophomore, Rachel Bersini, will present tonight in the final round. Additionally, our first team, Andrew King and Zach Learman, will compete in this evening's finals. To say that we are grateful for the tremendous student interest would be an understatement. Just as we hoped when we designed the program, the pitch is really a display of liberal arts learning. The CCL takes great pride in this, but we know too it is a reflection of the long tradition of student ingenuity at HWS, as well as the dynamic educational environment that so many at the colleges sustain. Tonight marks the conclusion of a six-month contest experience for our four pitch finalists. As we gather tonight for the contest's final round, I should tell you all where it began. This fall, we sent out a call for proposals. We told students to outline their ideas for products, services, and organizations. They could be for-profit or nonprofit. They could be business, educational, political, environmental. We wanted to support all genres of entrepreneurship. I must thank our fantastic selection committee who had the difficult task of reviewing proposals in 1 week in order to narrow the field. They chose six semifinalists, and we matched each with an alumni mentor. These mentors assisted students as they revised and strengthened their proposals, offering as much life advice as entrepreneur expertise. The mentors have become central to the pitch. We'd like to sincerely thank all of our mentors, as we know many of them are watching at home on the live link, and Chrissy Bennett West is here with us tonight. Their passion in seeing the students succeed stood out as boldly as the ideas that the students created. At the end of the second round, our selection committee decided on four finalists. These finalists are with us now. They have withstood two rigorous rounds where a written proposal was emphasized. Their task tonight is much different. Tonight we've asked them to pitch their idea to a panel of judges, who is an extraordinary group that we have gathered to help us select one finalist with the most action-ready idea. The panel is the last component of an applied learning experience the pitch contest provides. Our judges represent any boardroom, any stakeholder, any opportunity where an individual with an idea must walk through a door and make a case for others to invest in them. Great courage is a part of entrepreneurial leadership. So too is passion. To get here, our finalists have already demonstrated both. To win the grant, they will need to convince our panel that they will do what they say they can do. Much like the TV experience of Shark Tank, tonight's event does not accurately capture all the hundreds of hours our student finalists have put in to prepare. Although we've asked our finalists to present a pitch worthy of the final round, their ideas, of course, are very much works in progress. So before we begin, let me be very clear. Rachel, Zach, Drew, Maddie and Mimi, we are extraordinarily proud of the work you have done thus far. Thank What a great evening to mark how far you have come. On behalf of the Centennial Center for Leadership, I want to thank President Guerin for his commitment to our contest, as well as Provost Ufamada, who is with us tonight. In just her second semester here at the colleges, Provost Ufamada has quickly become one of the pitch's greatest supporters. I'd like to welcome her to the stage to introduce our panel.
Good evening, and welcome to our campus. It's a real pleasure to look out from here and see so many faces and so many people in the audience. And it's for a good occasion and for a good cause. So thank you very much for all the parents and members of the community, students, and especially our judges and all the people who prepared the students for tonight. As a liberal arts institution, we pride ourselves on our ability to cultivate innovative critical thinkers. Our students at Hobart and William Smith Colleges are immersed in an academic environment where thoughtful problem solving, intellectual curiosity, and calculated risk taking are already embraced. In many ways, the pitch is a celebration of the HWS experience. The contest is a demonstration of our values as an institution. We believe in ideas that add value. We challenge students to apply their talents towards ideas that will create positive change and add intellectual value to markets and communities. We also believe that it is our duty that wherever we're located, that we become useful members of that community. And for that reason, we're very, very conscious of our stewardship of our place and the communities in which we find ourselves. The pitch is in its second year. Although it's organized by and sponsored by the Centennial Center for Leadership, it is a program that touches all faces of the HWS community. Over the last 2 years, 71 students, as well as teams, have participated in the pitch. 78 proposals were submitted, 14 alums have served as mentors, and 5 have also served as judges. 14 members of our faculty and staff have served on the selection committees. Additionally, 4 local entrepreneurs have served on the selection committees over the past 2 years. So it is very much a community effort. Cultivating these entrepreneurial leaders couldn't be more important than it is now in our country and in our community. And please remember that here at HWS, we actually see our community as the globe. We're not restricted by geography. We see our worlds as comprising of our campus, the lake, which we really value, the city of Geneva, where we're located, our country, and the entire globe. And so it's with real pleasure that I commend the work that all our students have done, all the students who participated in the pitch this year and last year, and all the people who worked to help them. I especially applaud our 4 finalists who have worked hard, thought carefully, and taking a significant risk to be here tonight. I look forward to hearing their ideas. Regardless of who wins tonight, it's been the opportunity for you to discover your interests and test your real world capabilities that are really important. As far as I am concerned, you're all winners. Healthy competition can draw out the very best in all of us, and certainly we take great satisfaction when we see our students choose to work where they're contributing, creating, and adding value. At this point, it is my pleasure to introduce our panel of very, very strong and good judges, and I will do that and go through the group one by one. And when I'm done, you will see why we're so proud to have them here and feel really fortunate that they accepted to do this for us. And so I will start from the end of the table there. And so the first person there is Bruce Kingman. You see him at the end of the table. He's Associate Provost of Entrepreneurship and Innovation, and also Professor of Entrepreneurship at Whitman School of Management and School of Information Studies at Syracuse University. Sitting right next to him is Sandy Gross, class of 85, founder and managing partner of Pintum Partners. So you see, she's one of our own right there. And sitting next to her is Max Henry, class of 78, another of ours. You see how proud we are. We never let ours go. We always make sure that we pull them back in. And he's the owner of Hummingbird Leadership and seasoned executive. Is the owner of Hummingbird Leadership and is a seasoned executive within diverse set of industries, including consumer and technology companies. So you see, already you see all the diverse experiences we have there on the table. And next to him, we have another of our own, Stuart Liblan, who is president of the Residue National Corporation and a longtime entrepreneur. And you see again what we are doing here. It's all in the family, surrounded by friends. And the last person on the table there, not the least, is Duncan Moore, Vice Provost of Entrepreneurship and Professor of Engineering and Business Administration at the William E. Simon Graduate School of Business Administration at the University of Rochester. He also shares something with our president, who's not here tonight. They both served in the Clinton administration. And having completed the introduction, I want to say that we're delighted to have you here. We're very grateful that you are part of this, and we will now proceed with the program as written. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Provost Ufumata. Okay, so a few days ago, we asked our Facebook and Twitter followers at the Centennial Center for Leadership to post questions to the pitch judges. So I'd like to try that now. Let's start with Bruce. Bruce, what are the ingredients of a good idea?
Working?
Yep.
There we go. Okay. So the best ideas solve a problem or need. And that sounds sort of trite and sounds easy, but the important thing is not, it's not a problem or need in your head. It's a problem and need of other people. Students come to my office all the time with great ideas, and the first thing I do is send them out to find 30 customers, which usually means they have to talk to 100 people to find 30 individuals that also think it's a problem or a need. I get plenty of students that think it's a problem in their head, but after they go out there and test it in the market, then they figure out whether or not it's something good. I would say second, you have to have the ability to do it, or you have to have a team that constitutes the ability to do it. If it needs a website, if it needs an app, then you better know how to program an app, or you better have somebody on your team that knows how to program an app, right? You need the whole set of people that can actually implement that idea. And the most important thing is that you actually do it. At Syracuse University, we have this model called Dream, Believe, Pursue. And I always tell the students that the most important word in that is the pursue word. I get plenty of students that can dream. I get plenty of students that can believe in their idea, but it's only the ones that take seriously that last word and actually pursue it that are able to implement something and do something great.
Thank you. Very nice. Okay, this next one's for Sandy. What can a liberal arts education provide an entrepreneur?
That's a great question. I think it's, first of all, I think being coming out of a liberal arts background, it's you're open-minded and having a bi-discipline or having a multi-disciplinary approach to business, being pragmatic, living in the moment, and being and just being pragmatic versus being theoretical for the most part, and being a good listener, and thinking about different venues and just listening all the time and taking in different perspectives, knowing that there are different answers and taking into account different venues. A lot of times I think people are, they have one objective in mind. And I think having a liberal arts background, you take into account many different ideas and that can open up your eyes to, you know, many different solutions. And I know coming out of a liberal arts background, I've been open-minded. And I think I come to different, to a problem with many different ideas and have many different solutions. And I think that's one of the advantages of having a liberal arts background.
Very good. Thank you, Sandy. Okay, this one is actually for Duncan. We're going out of order. Okay. I don't want to upset the Twitterverse. I'm just going to go in order. Okay.
This is not allowed.
Can innovation be learned?
Yes, and in fact, I think you're innovative when you're born. When you're born, as your young child, and if you have young children, you constantly hear the word why. Why is something like this? Why is it? And as you get older and older, we somehow beat that out of kids. That by the time they get into college, you're not asking as much about why things are happening. And so I think it is inherent in the human spirit that it's there. One of the things that I do want to make a mention of, because we've talked about this thing, which has nothing to do with the question, but that's why I'm an entrepreneur. on Friday of this week, the two-page proposals are due for the state business plan contest. It's a $100,000 prize. All you have to do is submit two pages to the Finger Lakes competition, which is being hosted at Rochester and RIT. So even if you didn't make the finals here tonight, one of the things you're going to learn in doing entrepreneurship is when you hear no, you always want to ask why. You want to find out why they said no, because that's how you build on that. And so even if you didn't make the finals for this, I would encourage you to submit. There's almost no downside. You've got all the material here already. And you only got to probably cut it down to two pages. So I encourage you to do that. Sorry.
No, it's okay.
We'll go back to the script now.
Yeah, I've already lost control. It's fine. This one's for Stu. What aspects of your athletic career have prepared you for your entrepreneurial work?
Well, I think that, first of all, as a person involved in athletics, a key component is your competitiveness. And I don't think any athlete can get to any level, certainly the college level or the professional level, without some extraordinary competitive fire in them. And I think that directly relates to entrepreneurs, their willingness to take a risk, an athlete's willingness to take a risk every day. You know, and I also think that self-awareness, you know, athletes all over the world, in order to get better, have to identify where they need work or their strengths and weaknesses and then concentrate on them. And I think that's a key component. And, you know, I think the last thing is willingness to take a risk. I think that most entrepreneurs, like you pointed out earlier, the most key component is the willingness to take a risk. And, you know, there's a funny saying that, you know, good ideas are like having children. They are easier to conceive than to deliver.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of student athletes, their willingness to take a risk and to actually push forward is a key component to their success.
Good. Very good. Thank you. Yep. Okay. And last, we have one for Max. What distinguishes great entrepreneurial leaders? It's a tough one, I know.
I think the number one thing all of us wanted to say is we're very impressed with the turnout tonight. So yeah. Thank you very much for all coming tonight. It's outstanding. The two things I would suggest is, to piggyback on Bruce, is number one, it's people. You pick the people you work with, you pick the people who help you, you pick the first customers you want to get, you pick different things, and it's all about people. A lot of entrepreneurs forget that, and they get caught up in lots of different things, but it all nets out to, and the most important thing is people. How to select people, pick people, find the right partners, do other things, that's about asking great questions. So I encourage all of you to always ask great questions and listen well, and that'll help you with whatever you do, and especially in being an entrepreneur. Thank you.
Thank you. We've obviously gathered the right panel. Thank you all for coming. We really appreciate, and we'll have Bruce and Duncan considered extended family members from here on out. Okay, the time has come for our pitch presentations. I want to briefly cover a few important items in terms of the show format. The audience should know that our judges are looking for four different criteria: innovativeness, clarity of idea, strategic planning, and impact of idea. Each finalist has 8 minutes of uninterrupted time with their pitch. After each presentation, our judges will have time to ask the finalists questions. Once all four finalists have finished, our judges will be excused for deliberation and our audience can enjoy desserts during a brief intermission. During our intermission, we're going to ask for our audience to participate in an online poll, and we'll have a guest appearance from last year's pitch winner. Afterwards, we'll announce the winner of our $10,000 pitch grant. Okay, so to start off this evening, I'd like to invite to the stage our first finalist, Rachel Bersini. Rachel is a sophomore public policy major who worked closely with her pitch mentor, Susan Yolen, William Smith alumni, who is the Vice President of Public Affairs and Communications at Planned Parenthood of Southern New England. Won't you please welcome Rachel, the creator of the I'm Outstanding campaign.
Professors, 110 students, nearly all of campus safety, Hobart's Division I lacrosse team, and 230 photos later, the I'm Outstanding campaign has helped brighten this campus poster by poster. The I'm Outstanding campaign started with an idea with three people sitting around a table. Today, the campaign's impact at HWS is undeniable. The I'm Outstanding campaign is a visual movement to highlight allied, out, and supportive members of the LGBT community. The mission of I'm Outstanding is to increase awareness, inclusiveness, and acceptance for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender people, as well as their allies. It started here at HWS as a simple poster campaign. It shows parents, current students, and prospective students that there is an LGBT community on this campus and that that community has support. The power of the campaign comes from using recognizable community members on posters and distributing them throughout campus. Whether you are out and proud, not shy to be bi, terrifically trans, love someone who is gay, support the LGBT community, or are a proud ally, there is no question that the visual aspect of the campaign is compelling. I'm Outstanding is unique because it connects allies and supporters with LGBT people. It erases the sense of us and them and creates a community that we can all feel comfortable in. I'll be honest with you. When I pitched my idea for I'm Outstanding to my fellow Pride Alliance board members, we thought that it wouldn't amount to much. I knocked on our communications office door and asked if they would help with a photo shoot. We expected that we might get 20 people. Imagine our surprise when 4 photo shoots later, we had over 200 people eager to get their picture taken and participate in this campaign. The enthusiasm increased when I'm Outstanding began to incorporate social media. Once we posted the photos from the campaign online, I began hearing from people in Italy and Australia. Organizations, high schools, colleges, and individuals from Arizona, Rhode Island, North Carolina, and Maryland reached out with interest about how they could bring I'm Outstanding to their area. More importantly, we started to track the dialogue that the campaign was inspiring. Individuals wanted their stories heard. I'm Outstanding means more than just posters and can be a catalyst for social change. The LGBT movement started on June 27, 1969 with the Stonewall riots and has focused on many issues in the last 44 years. The LGBT community is no stranger to activism, and my work would not be possible without the decades of passionate activists before me. However, LGBT issues continue to be a civil rights issue of my generation, and this campaign centers on relevance. With the guidance from my pitch mentor, Susan Yolen, I am now poised to take the campaign to more college campuses. Union College, Hamilton College, Babson College, the University of Rhode Island, Syracuse University, and Northeastern University have expressed interest in I'm Outstanding. Over the next few months, I will develop this poster campaign into a meaningful educational program that stimulates compelling conversations with the goal of shifting intolerance towards understanding and, more importantly, acceptance. I'm Outstanding is collaborating with researchers and educators to create a curriculum and training kit. In our work, we have realized that having discussions with young people about identity is critical. As you'll see on page 3 of the handout you have, once a school signs on with I'm Outstanding, it will be supported with a pre-poster discussion guide, which will prepare campaign participants for the impact that I'm Outstanding can have on an individual as well as a community, and that will focus on important dialogue that deepens understanding around difference, phobia, and why intolerance persists. How-to instructions with the steps to implement an I'm Outstanding campaign, the 6 signature foam core signs, and a post-poster forum guide, because after the posters are distributed, it will be as important to have a follow-up session where participants can process, discuss, and reflect on the impact. It will also serve as a call to action. We want to compel participants towards further advocacy and activism. I will be working with campus representatives, largely using existing Pride organizations, to establish the I'm Outstanding campaign across college campuses. My goal is to have established 5 outstanding campuses by the beginning of the 2013-2014 academic year. As I'm Outstanding continues to spread its message, I will work to take what was a small HWS initiative into a sustainable organization. As a national nonprofit organization, I'm Outstanding will house both the visual awareness campaign as well as the educational component. It will be an organization centered on providing a service to young people by partnering with like-minded organizations to further education and research and eventually donating back to the LGBT community. I understand that this is a few years away, but this is where I know my team and I can take I'm Outstanding. With this $10,000 grant, I will develop an interactive website, build pre- and post-training curriculum, continue outreach to other campuses, and file important nonprofit and trademarking paperwork. In order to keep I'm Outstanding affordable for all college campuses, I must keep my costs low. I am estimating each campus would need $300 to bring I'm Outstanding to its community. Certainly, this would assist my costs, but in order to gain real growth, I need support. I'll be a junior next year, and part of my learning will be balance. But what I have learned over the past 3 months will allow me to do this work, which honors my mom, the reason I am proud to hold the I Love Someone Who Is Gay sign. The impact and success I'm Outstanding has enjoyed is about more than the number of participants. It's about the people, the lives behind the signs on those posters. I would like to share with you an email I received last semester from a first-year William Smith student who comes from a conservative family. Dear Rachel, when I came to campus in the fall of 2012, I kept my sexual identity hidden for the first few months until I started seeing the I'm Outstanding posters around campus. Seeing my peers, professors, and members of my community express their support for the LGBT community on my college's campus made me realize that I am not alone. And there are people that support my sexual identity and want me to feel safe and happy as a student of Hobart and William Smith Colleges. I was so happy and excited about this campaign because I felt like it was the perfect opportunity for me to come out on this campus. It took me quite a while to gain the courage and confidence to get my picture taken with the I'm Out and Proud sign, but once I did, I felt amazing. I was so proud of myself for overcoming my fears and expressing a part of my identity that is so important to me. This campaign gave me the confidence to do one of the most challenging things an LGBT person has to do, which was to go home and come out to my family and friends. Rachel Brissini, your I'm Outstanding campaign changed my life. Thank you.
All right. Rachel, it sounds like a great idea, and it sounds like you've had a lot of success here. Talk to me about whether or not this is a nonprofit organization or this is a campus student group instead. And a lot of that probably has to do with your financial sustainability ideas, okay?
Right. As a visual campaign, the idea is compelling. But what I realize is that the campaign can be so much more. It can be an organization that centers on education, and that's one of the main reasons I wanted to implement this training around the campaign. You know, give people the dialogue that they need to have appropriate conversations around LGBT issues. And then part of the reason that I wanted to become a nonprofit organization was to donate back to the LGBT community. Recently, over in the fall when Hurricane Sandy, I suppose that's when it was, attacked New York City, the Allie Forney Center was destroyed. And that is the only place that LGBT homeless youth in New York feel safe. And that's 40% of homeless youth identify as LGBT. So, you know, to me, that was a really alarming message. I feel very safe at Hobart and William Smith Colleges. I have a support system as an ally in the Pride Alliance, but these are people that have nowhere else to go. So, as a nonprofit, certainly there would be that visual aspect, but the education, the donating back, the building merchandise would all be part of that.
I thought your presentation was amazing.
Thank you.
You were very articulate, and I congratulate you on that. Is this something that you see pursuing as a career going forward?
Certainly. I am about to declare myself as a sociology major, and I think social systems are fascinating. But another thing that I need to recognize is that I am not identifying myself as LGBT, and there is an entire history associated with this movement. So currently I'm in two LGBT studies courses to really ground myself in the work that I'm about to be doing. This is something that I'm absolutely passionate about, and it's something that I could see myself following for the next 20 to 30 years.
It was outstanding. Are you considering partners?
I have considered partners. The Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network, I have a contact with, and we've discussed how GLSEN might partner with the I'm Outstanding campaign, but I really do see this growing as its own sustainable nonprofit organization.
There don't seem to be a lot of barriers to entry in this business. It seems to be posters and reaching out. And my question is, how does this differ from local clubs at colleges that you hear about every day? And the second part of the question is, when you enter a college community with your posters, et cetera, how do you deal with the dilution of if there are local clubs that already exist?
The thing that's different about the campaign is that I connect with those clubs. It is not a club in and of itself, but it's an outlet for Pride organizations, For example, the No Hate campaign we've had on our campus before, but to me, that's almost negative. You know, you're putting duct tape over your mouth, you're saying no hate, and then once Proposition 8 is, you know, declared unconstitutional, now what do we do? This is positive. This is something that Pride organizations can hold on to and say, look what we brought to our campus. Look what we did here to make all of us feel safe. And do you mind repeating the second part of your question?
Sure. Just how do you deal with the dilution if you're going to college campuses that already have local clubs and local support groups? How do you become more significant? How do you become in the forefront of the goal of your business?
Okay. Well, to answer your question, resource centers, Pride organizations can use this as a tool to engender social change on their campus further. It certainly adds value to those types of organizations that already exist. And it also creates teachable moments. You know, in my experience, there's always more to learn. And especially with LGBT issues, there's a glossary of terms that grows every day. You know, intersex, what does that mean? Does everyone know what that means? What is gender expression versus gender identity? And so this would be a resource for these schools to say, okay, I know because I'm in the Pride organization what these terms mean, but let me have a forum for my entire campus so that we all understand and then learn to accept the differences between the LGBT community.
So I sat with you at dinner tonight, and I know how nervous you were, and you didn't come across at all nervous, so congratulations, even though you didn't even eat your salary. So I don't know whether you've eaten anything today, for that matter. Just because you're a not-for-profit doesn't mean you've got to generate revenue. It just means on the U.S. tax code you don't pay taxes. How are you going to generate the revenue in the long term to sustain this? I mean, this is you say it's going to be $300 per campus. I don't think that's really right, but that's not here and there. But how are you going to be able to sustain this for 20 years?
One of the plans that I have, of course, my target audience right now for the next 6 months is college campuses, but I've also thought about entering high schools. There is definitely a need for this type of education in high schools. And then also with merchandise, I can imagine 500 people at the Pride event in New York City coming up this summer wearing I'm out in proud shirts or I'm not shy to be bi because I'm outstanding. And, you know, selling those t-shirts, selling stickers, selling the training kits, as well as donations. If you're a nonprofit organization, you can really rely and hope that people will donate to your continued success.
What I was going to add to that is I think to really get funding is I think you'd really need to get corporate sponsorship to really bring in, you know, greater capital to fund this, you know, to continue it.
Of course, I have connections with Collage, the Children of Lesbian and Gays Everywhere, the Family Equality Council, which is currently based in Boston, Glisten, a contact in New York City. You know, I've got connections. I've been in conversation with these people, and it would either be a partnership or a sponsorship. And, you know, I said, I want to get through the pitch first to know if I can do it on my own. We'll make an organization. If not, I would be open to partnering.
Great, thank you.
Okay. Very nicely done, Rachel. Thank you, team, over here. Our second finalist is a team of Hobart students. Senior Zach Learman is an economics major and English major. Junior Andrew King is an architectural studies major. They were paired with pitch mentor Reed Jackson, Hobart alum, who is the vice president of Aptico Technology Group. Won't you please welcome Zach and Drew to the stage to present Space Final.
Hi, my name is Andrew King.
And I'm Zach Lerman.
And we are Space Final.
I can't believe, Drew, that it's only been a few months since we started this. Now, Space Final, recently established as an LLC, means that we are officially partners.
We are a keyboard accessory company that specializes in the sale of custom-designed removable vinyl stickers. You're probably wondering how this all started. Well, about a year ago, I bought my first vinyl cutter to make stickers for my friends, my family, and myself. One day, I asked myself, why is the space bar the biggest key on the keyboard, the only key without a character on it.
From there, Drew decided to put something on it. He took those custom design skills and applied it to the creation of vinyl spacebar stickers. You know, Drew, we live in an era where having a computer is vital to maintaining connection with the world.
Who here has a computer? Just as we thought. In 2011 alone, there were over 95 million computers sold in the United States. We believe that the market potential for creative keyboard accessories is extraordinary.
Currently, we are making sales on an individual basis. With the development of our website, we will be able to capture larger markets by offering a selection of preset and custom designs.
Space Vinyl will go after the youth market. They are the individuals most interested in accessorizing their computers. Since our product has a unique creative spin, we believe that once an individual buys a spacebar sticker, their friends will want one too. Whether it's an environmentalist, sports enthusiast, or artist, Space Vinyl will be the buzz amongst young consumers.
Drew, you didn't tell us how we're going to sell it.
Well, Zach, we'll be selling each sticker at a price of $2.50. $2.50 may seem like a lot, but each sticker will come in a customized black envelope and contain the sticker of the customer's choosing, as well as the Space Vinyl logo sticker on the house.
Currently, our cost of production is extremely low. With our current cutter, we can produce each sticker for just 33 cents, which includes the cost of equipment, tools, and packaging materials. Each roll of vinyl has the capacity to produce 2,160 stickers based on our spacebar dimensions. For every roll of vinyl sold, we will generate $5,400 in revenue.
And how many stickers do we need to break even?
Well, to cover all of our one-time costs, we would need to sell 2,671 stickers. This is something that we hope to accomplish with the sales on our website alone.
This brings us to our next step for our product growth. We need to have the capacity to make stickers on a larger scale. Currently, our average time per sticker is around 3 minutes. You can see how fulfilling an order of 2,000 would be challenging to say the very least. This would take over 180 hours of labor. With our new vinyl cutter, we could cut our production time from 3 minutes per sticker to just 1 second per sticker. This would allow us to fill high volume orders in a natural fit market, college students.
The Space Vinyl team is working to finalize a deal with the HWS admissions office to create 500 stickers to give out to prospective students and families. We will always be loyal to HWS, and we intend to reach out to other admissions offices to show them how our product can increase school visibility. Space Vinyl stickers with school logos can be sold in college stores as athletic merchandise, degree organizations, alumni, and even the IT desk, where a custom IT service hotline number could be placed on every laptop.
Given the potential for bulk orders and the desire for schools to leave their mark with the students, we have a goal to sell 20,000 stickers by the end of 2013 through this channel.
Can you imagine walking into any school library and seeing the school logo on every laptop or keyboard? Well, we can. The possibilities within this market seem endless.
With the ability to mass produce, we could distribute through more channels, such as an Etsy account, which was started by several young entrepreneurs, much like ourselves.
We can only achieve this level of sales with the $10,000 provided in funding by this grant. This funding is essential if we are to establish ourselves as the go-to keyboard accessory company on the market.
This funding will allow us to buy our new vinyl cutter, purchase more materials, create and complete important intellectual property processes, and create our website. Additionally, this funding will help us combat one of our potential weaknesses.
What's that, Drew?
Even with great profit margins, the Space Vinyl stickers run the risk of being a fad product. This is a serious concern for the Space Vinyl team.
In the business world, there is a model for a product lifecycle, which consists of 5 stages. The development of the product, its introduction to the market, the growth of the product, its maturity, and then its decline. The lifecycle of a fad product is shorter than that of most products. Its maturity is short-lived, and its decline is rapid. We must have a multi-phase approach to extend the life of our product. This brings us to our newest innovation.
We believe that our product has a tremendous opportunity to be used by other companies for marketing.
Space Vinyl can use our stickers as a tool to market products, events, services, and even causes for other organizations. We can take our sticker design innovations and create a platform for other companies to appeal to youth customers who love to personalize their computers.
How do we do that, Zach?
Over the past several months, we've created our signature No Space is Safe marketing concept. We placed our company logo in unexpected locations across campus and downtown. Afterwards, we saw a dramatic spike in followers on our company Facebook and Instagram accounts.
Oh, that's right, Zach. We use the No Spaces Safe concept as a guerrilla marketing technique.
Guerrilla marketing is the fastest growing marketing strategy today. We will show other companies how to capture the youth market by using keyboard accessories to increase their sales.
The No Spaces Safe concept is based off of careful market analysis and sophisticated target audience data. With every organization using Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, Space Final would establish itself as a company that works outside of these oversaturated spaces.
True. You almost forgot to tell them about our first marketing customer.
Zach, you know I never forget anything. I just wanted you to tell
them. Sure, dude. We ran our marketing concept by last year's pitch winner, Sarah Wobluski, and she was interested in the sticker bombing campaign to help her company grow. As a savvy entrepreneur, she understands how effective this marketing technique can be. If you want to gain attention for your business, particularly within the youth market, put your information on every keyboard for young people to see before they check their Facebook or place an order off Amazon.
Because of the versatility of our product and its low cost, we can even create stickers that promote important causes such as breast cancer awareness, the Wounded Warrior Project, and even the environment, which give back and create positive impacts.
Speaking of the environment, we've developed a strategy that prevents our customers from contributing to the harmful disposal of plastic and also gives them an incentive to purchase another sticker. We offer to our customers the chance to send us in their old sticker and purchase a new one for 30% off. Space Final will recycle the plastic for them.
As you can see, we have developed an innovative product with a company strategy for a long-term market presence. With your savvy business skills and my creative mind, our opportunities seem endless.
We want to take this company from selling 50 stickers in Scandling Center in 2 hours to selling thousands a year through our different channels. I know we started this company from our dorm room, but we have big plans for it. And as entrepreneurial leaders, we get to take all that we have learned in HWS and apply it to something that we are truly passionate about.
That's right, Zach. From Space Final, we just want to say thanks.
Thank you. I have mine.
Yeah, you all have it in your brochure there.
Who are your competitors?
Well, the only competitor we're really dealing with right now is a company called Who's. It's just backed by Kickstarter, but they make vinyl custom stickers for the butt ends of iPhone chargers and iPad chargers, all that. And they actually charge $10 per sticker, and we only charge $2.50 a sticker.
So what's the intellectual property here? Why can't I start making them in my dorm room? Of which I don't have one, but.
Well, we're trademarked. We're established as an LLC. We're still exploring the patent process on the sticker itself. But one thing that we have for the sustainability of our product is that we've been in touch with a programmer and app developer who has recently informed us that it's actually possible to create a digital app for tablets, droids, or iPhones where you could create a custom of your choosing design for your spacebar on any one of those products.
Okay.
And that is patentable.
First of all, I'd like to buy all of your scrap.
Sure.
Vinyl. I can be an instant customer for you. My concern is, have you guys found out any information or considered trademark infringement with the computer companies that you're putting these on, or even the licensing agreements with college names instead of just printing them? Have you considered the legality of if you're allowed to print them or allowed to put them on these products?
Well, certainly we would finalize a deal with any one of those organizations before we did that. We have explored the long term of it, such as licensing that to the NFL or the NCAA. Unfortunately, they require that we were in business for 3 years. We just started. Hopefully, in the next 2 years, we can develop a strategy where we can approach them to be sold in any one of their stadiums or online and offer them a royalty to, you know, sell these stickers in their stadium, and we'll say we'll give you 25 cents per return of sticker that you sell. But other than that, we haven't run into any legality.
Just a follow-up question. If you're how do you know you can promise them 25 cents out of every sticker? Do you have any idea what an NFL team or NBA team or even a college would charge to allow you to put their names on these products?
I do not, but I know from our low-cost perspective that promising them, you know, if they were required for that royalty, that I don't think that would be a problem. That's certainly something that would be useful.
Just because they might want to get paid up front and not per sticker. So
sure.
To give you the licensing, if they're going to charge you $100,000 to use their name and you only end up selling 1,000 stickers, certainly might be a concern.
Hopefully within the next 2 to 3 years, we'll figure that out.
Once you have this product and you know that it's good, what other avenues would you think about exploring in terms of, you know, besides keyboards?
Yeah, well, we're actually in the development right now of a vinyl sticker that covers a tablet on an iPad. And we just have a prototype right now, so we weren't willing to throw it into our presentation, but it basically just covers the whole border of the tablet, and it's just a little customized, and it would just be on the website under all the different templates that you can order.
So think a little bit bigger. Is this something that's just a cute thing to do in your dorm room, or something that you know, can give you lifetime employment out of this product? What are your goals?
I mean, our goals are definitely lifetime employment, without a doubt. Yeah, but I mean, we're just starting right now. It's just this is all we really got from our dorm room. But with this $10,000 grant, hopefully we can get a new vinyl cutter, maybe get a space downtown Geneva where it's pretty cheap to get a space now because it's 60% vacant down there. But then hopefully from there we can just build ourselves up and keep going. Sky's the limit, you know?
Scale it out from there.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Getting interesting. Great job, Zach and Drew. I'm going to invite our third finalist, who is a senior architectural studies student who is mentored by a number of alums, including Ira Goldschmidt, Hobart alum who's the owner of Goldschmidt Engineering Solutions. Matthew Mead has created a company called Hempitexture. Please welcome Maddie to the stage.
Good evening. My name is Matthew Mead, and tonight I'm going to share my vision for an environmentally ethical approach to architecture. As I begin, I'd like you all to consider that during every second of this presentation, 2.4 million pounds of carbon dioxide are being released into the atmosphere. The United States building sector accounts for 46.7% of our domestic carbon production. Why is it that our homes, the buildings we work in, live in, and learn in, are such dramatic contributors to climate change? Is it because maybe you didn't turn a lamp off before you left your room tonight? Or maybe the heat is on, your window's wide open? Or maybe the problem's much deeper than that. Perhaps it's a fundamental flaw in how we perceive modern building and energy consumption. What if I told you the carbon footprint of the building sector could be mitigated by the use of a rapidly renewable and carbon-negative raw material? This raw material, with an estimated 50,000 uses, from automotive panels to building materials and textiles, is industrial hemp. Unfortunately, hemp production was outlawed in 1937, and since then, its vast potential has been mostly forgotten from mainstream American thought. In our 21st century society, where we are capable and morally responsible for ethical decisions that impact our environment, do you believe that antiquated and misguided legislation should stand in the way of modern, progressive, and truly sustainable solutions? I don't, and that's why I'm here tonight to tell you about my company, Hempitexture. In the simplest sense, Hempitexture is an innovation and design company that develops building materials made primarily from hemp fiber. By building with hemp fiber, we can avoid using unsustainable materials that have a high carbon footprint. Our impact on the environment due to our consumption of natural resources is evident. We must transition our conceptions of architecture towards a practice that is harmonious with nature. Building with hemp is the most effective way to build in harmony with nature because of its carbon negative and rapidly renewable qualities. As the UK and other European countries continue to mainstream hemp as a sustainable practice, the United States remains behind the apex of this growing industry. In December of 2012, a London university awarded its commission for its new state-of-the-art research center to the prestigious architecture firm Archetype. This building hails the most sustainable and energy-efficient building in the entire United Kingdom is built with hemp. I reference this project to ground my idea in a factual reality as a method that is being chosen by Europe's brightest architects who are making strides to mitigate the building sector's impact on our climate. The primary product Hempertexture intends to take to market is called Fiber Interblock. Fiber Interblock is a biodegradable, carbon negative, and insulating alternative to conventional building block systems. This block has an interlocking design that is meant to increase efficiency in the construction process, ultimately lowering the labor cost. The interlocking blocks can be likened to Legos. The extrusions allow the next block to join firmly in place with subsequent blocks. Once stacked to the necessary height, the voids of the blocks can be poured with reinforced concrete to create a structurally stable and energy-efficient building. The most valuable quality of fiber interblock is its excellent thermal and insulation properties, making it a superior insulating component. A hemp wall with a thickness of around 12 inches has a significantly high R value of around 25, and this is without any additional insulation or external finishing. The health of a home is directly tied to the materials that it is made with. Hempertexture's products will be made from organic materials and would never incorporate toxic chemicals like formaldehyde found in most modern building materials. Hempertexture is considered a wide variety of bonding agents to solidify the fiber interblock into its desired form. The most commonly used binder for hemp construction is lime. However, lime has a significantly high carbon footprint. Hempertexture is seeking the most progressively sustainable methods to create its products with the goal of minimizing the building sector's impact on our climate. With the guidance of one of my entrepreneurial mentors, Hobart graduate J.B. Blanchard, I have developed a connection to Solidia Technologies, a sustainable technology company that has a revolutionary process that will enable Hempertexture to create a hemp building product unlike any other in the world. Solidia has a high-performance bonding agent that is made mostly from natural minerals like calcium silicate. Solidia materials are stronger than concrete, they are lightweight, and they are fireproof. Fiber interblock, comprised of both hemp fiber and the Solidia binder, will be hardened through a low-temperature solidification system. In this process, the raw hemp fiber and the Solidia binding matrix are combined within proportion. The mixture can then be placed into a mold to create the desired shape. The block is then hardened by introducing pressurized carbon to the block, causing a molecular reaction that actually embodies up to 20% of the block's volume in carbon. Hempertexture has a clear vision as to how this product will be taken to market, originating from the initial concept. The $10,000 granted by the pitch is absolutely needed as seed money to fulfill the necessary business prerequisites. Hempertexture must file for an LLC, and Hempertexture must be trademarked immediately. Financial support will also allow me to bring the design to the level of specificity required for beginning a patent application. These actions will further legitimize Hempertexture and position Hempertexture to receive capital investments. I recognize that Hempertexture is a long-term endeavor, but it cannot be catalyzed without this $10,000 grant. Following these necessary prerequisites, Hempertexture will develop an already established connection with Grinnell Incorporated, the Northeast's largest producer of stone and concrete blocks. Grinnell is already licensed to use Solidia's technology, so partnering with them will be an easily integrated process. I estimate that when the intellectual property rights are filed and necessary capital is acquired, Hempertexture will go into the initial production and testing phase of fiber interblock within 1 year. And Hempertexture's fiber interblock will be marketed as a progressively sustainable building material to the rapidly growing green building industry. I am at the ground floor of a movement that is picking up speed. This past November, Colorado legalized the production of industrial hemp, and in February, Kentucky announced similar legislation that would also allow the legalization of domestic hemp production. The success of hempitecture, however, is not contingent on a domestic shift in legality. But when the U.S. does transition to hemp production, hemp's versatility will carry over to the building sector, and hempitecture will already have its own pre-established niche. Fiber Interblock is just one of the many hemp product ideas I have conceived, and the potential for more is vast. I already have experience in starting a business from the ground up, and from this experience, I learned to dream even bigger. I wanted to take a challenging problem and solve it in an innovative way that benefits both society and the environment. In the 8 minutes I have spent here telling you about hempitecture, 1.1 billion pounds of carbon dioxide have been released into the atmosphere. It is possible to live in a world where this is not the case, where our homes and buildings we work, live in, and play in are built in balance with nature. Hempitecture is not just a company. It's a company that wants to change the way our society thinks about building with truly sustainable solutions. Thank you.
How long do the blocks last?
They are biodegradable, but they are biodegradable in the sense that the raw materials that they are made from can be returned back to the earth. So the blocks would have to be thoroughly smashed, exposed to the elements. The life cycle of the product is very long. I don't have a specific number, but just because of the fact they're biodegradable does not mean they're going to fall apart.
Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. I have a couple of questions for you. Whenever there's a new product that's introduced, you know, people have a hard time adjusting to change mm-hmm. and incorporating that into whatever they've been doing. And you compared hemp to concrete. You know, in terms of the price of hemp and also the availability of hemp and also people, you know, incorporating this into, you know, building, using it now. How long does it take for someone to start using it and learning how to use hemp? Can you talk to us about some of those items?
Essentially, what I'm trying to do by designing Fiber Interblock is empower all architects and builders with a nominal architectural device, a block. All architects and builders know how to build with the block. There's no necessarily learning curve to it. The structural method for it may have to be adapted, but that will already be a solved piece of the puzzle for the people who will be using it. In the video that I showed, you saw that the blocks are poured with reinforced concrete. That's a quick, sustainable, easy method to create a strong structure. So there really is no learning curve to it. It's just a matter of designing the product and then specifying how the architect or builder is supposed to employ that in the structure.
Thank you.
I'd like to do a follow-up on that. I'm very interested in this idea. But I have a question about regulatory issues. Who determines whether this product can be actually used?
That's a great question. And there are many governing bodies of different sort of regulations. The largest one is ASTM standards. And they basically decide if it can be used in a building or not. There is only one domestic competitor for hemp construction in the United States. So there already is one company. However, they use a not very environmentally sound method, but hempitecture intends to improve on that and offer a solution to builders and architects with a more sustainable
method. Actually, it's the towns and cities that regulate this, and that's your problem, because you're going to have to get the codes changed in lots of local jurisdictions in this country.
I don't believe that I would have to have the codes changed, because I don't think there's anything that would.
If you want to replace cinder blocks with this, I think you would, but there's a way out of this problem. And there is an organization at NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, that deals with building materials. So those are the people you want to go to try to get your product through the whole system and work with the American Builders Association or something like that.
Thank you for that advice. Appreciate that.
To Duncan's point, I do a little building out in Southampton, and they're a funny bunch, the municipalities.
I guess an addition put on.
Yeah, and it's going to take an awful lot of testing. Number one, is my building going to biodegrade that I'm building?
No, absolutely not. The solidia binding matrix is extremely strong. It is more lightweight and stronger than concrete. Solidia technology is already being used as a binding matrix for a variety of other materials. Just because the two things by themselves are biodegradable does not mean that they're just going to fall apart. When I say biodegradable, I only reference that to analyze it from a life cycle perspective point. After the building use is done, the hemp and the blocks could be smashed up and essentially turned into fertilizer for the ground.
The follow-up question to that is mostly in business. People, even though in concept, it's a nice idea of the carbon footprint, but really people in business are concerned with the bottom line and their cost. Can I make money? And they're not going to prefer a building material that's three times the cost just because it's green. Have you done any work with how this compares to the building supplies that are currently used today?
I understand that perspective, and just using the example of the other company that is doing hemp construction, they are competitive with other building methods, but we're looking at this product from a value-added perspective. Fiber interblock, while it might be more expensive, however, I would like it to be competitive with most other blocks. While it might be a little bit more expensive, the value-added perspective says that if you spend more money on the initial building and construction of your home for materials that are environmentally friendly as well as energy efficient, you're going to save a lot of money in the long run from energy savings that would essentially be thrown out the window or through the wall in this case.
But how much more is this product? What percentage more is this product than the stuff that's used today? Cinder blocks, drywall, et cetera.
It's difficult to pin that number down exactly because the nature of this is there's so many partnerships that are not necessarily fixed yet. But I do feel that the Hempitextures fiber interblock will be able to be competitive with other blocks because hemp is not very expensive. And hemp is being grown widespread in Canada. There's biofiber refineries in Canada that are popping up all over the place that are looking to unload this product to other markets. The United States market is a whole untapped market for this. And I think the consumer trends are trending towards green products that are truly sustainable.
You did a great job.
Thank you.
Okay, great work, Maddie. Our fourth and final finalist just finished her season with the William Smith swim team. She worked closely with pitch mentor Chrissy Bennett West, William Smith alumni who is assistant principal and special education teacher in the Canandaigua School District. Mimi Mahoney has developed Connectable Arts. Please welcome Mimi to the stage for our last pitch of the evening.
In my second grade yearbook, it says I want to be a teacher. As the years went on, there were many things in my life that changed, but my ambitions stayed the same. I still wanted to be a teacher. When I was a freshman in high school, my mom asked exactly what kind of teacher I wanted to be. I responded with passion that came deep within my heart. I don't know. I just want to help people. I want to make a difference in someone's life. Tonight, I will present to you Connectable Arts. Connectable Arts is an organization that connects college students with individuals with disabilities through art, music, and dance programs. This organization will enrich the understanding of college students towards individuals with both developmental and intellectual disabilities. For the past 2 years, I've dedicated myself to volunteering and learning about organizations that support individuals with disabilities. I feel like I'm fulfilling the goal I had so many years ago when I said I wanted to help people. But by creating Connectable Arts, I'm not only helping those individuals with disabilities, I'm shifting the perspective of college students who often form stereotypes towards these individuals. I will make a difference in both of these populations' lives. Connectable Arts is relationship driven. It is based upon the values of inclusion, respect, and understanding. This fall, I was able to form amazing relationships with members from the Ontario ARC, which is an organization that serves the needs to over 1,000 individuals with disabilities. Every Tuesday morning, I would spend time chatting, doing crafts, and getting to know 14 adults that had disabilities ranging from Down syndrome to intellectual impairments to speech impairments. I learned so much from this remarkable group of friends. Bruce walked in every morning in a shirt and tie. The way his eyes lit up when he saw me made me feel special, really important. He would always say the same thing when he walked through the door. Hey, how you been? Jody was the jokester of the bunch. The fact that he was unable to communicate verbally did not stop him from always trying to be the center of attention. And then there was Anna. She was sweet and motherly towards me. Anna always asked about my classes and made sure that I was studying hard. These relationships that I built compelled me to forming Connectable Arts. I was able to see how these individuals from the Ontario ARC really valued each other's friendships and how they all indisputably cared for one another. But even more than that, how they all genuinely cared about me. Connectable Arts will allow for college students to engage and compose similar rich relationships that I was able to form. Connectable Arts is an organization that I will create with a chapter model approach. My passion towards creating relationships between individuals with disabilities and college students will help me in creating the first Connectable Arts chapter here at HWS. I have recruited a group of devoted students that will stand as the first members of the Connectable Arts HWS chapter. Currently, I have an immense amount of support from the Ontario ARC, which will help me form more partnerships in the future. Over the next few months, I will implement the three core functions of Connectable Arts. These functions will be to create fun, yet educational, art, music, and dance programming, fundraise to support chapter activity, and further develop partnerships with community organizations that support individuals with disabilities. These items are already in place. What I need now is the funding so we can move forward. The Connectable Arts HWS chapter will serve as a pilot. Each chapter will receive a stipend of $500 along with a toolkit of information about how to start up a successful Connectable Arts chapter. Within the toolkit, each chapter will be provided with training on the art, music, and dance programs, marketing techniques, a structure for how to spend the stipend, and forms of assessment and evaluation of the programs. Because all campuses are different, each chapter will be encouraged to adapt the toolkit in ways which will allow for success at that institution. My role as founder of Connectable Arts will be to solidify the organization's programs and establish a growing chapter base. I will work to provide a list of potential organizations in each chapter area that we can partner with. As a Boston native, I plan to grow the next Connectable Arts chapters in the New England area after I return home from my May 2014 graduation. I am currently in contact with several colleges that are interested in having Connectable Arts programs on their campus. Our goal is to have Connectable Arts chapters successfully running at HWS as well as three other schools in the New England area by the spring semester of 2015. This grant is essential for us to move forward. It will be broken up into three main sections: program development, traveling, presenting, and training, and organizational platform. The Connectable Arts organization will thrive off of our website. It will stand as our virtual headquarters. This is where students will be able to learn how they can implement a Connectable Arts chapter on their campus. It will also serve as a financial avenue for collecting donations and selling merchandise in the future. After a successful implementation at HWS and growth at our New England schools, Connectable Arts will apply to become an official 501c3 nonprofit organization. Now, do not let my friendliness and outgoing personality fool you. I'm more than that. I'm an entrepreneur leader. I've created the Connectable Arts Organization, and I know that it has a future. I intend to give other college students the same opportunity to meet and interact with influential people, just like Bruce, Jody, and Anna. 6 months ago, I viewed $10,000 as winning the lottery. With the knowledge I've learned in business and cost structure, I now see that this grant will only last us between 1 and 2 years. But that is when I will apply for more grants. I will put together fundraisers. I will find sponsors. I will reach out to the communities. There are so many groups of people that believe in me and the Connectable Arts Organization already. Throughout my arts and athletic career, I've always been told how coachable I am. I am now ready to take all that I've learned and finally be the coach. Help me to make a difference and an impact on so many people's lives. Thank you.
So since I didn't get to ask a question the last one, I'm starting this one. Mimi, that was great, and I can tell that you have a lot of passion about it. I've actually had 2 siblings with special needs, and I know how important this would be. But it's a little unclear to me if you already started a chapter at HWS and how many students are interested in doing this. So does your passion translate into a larger student body?
That's a good question. This fall, I put together a festival for athletes and members of the dance program, as well as I reached out to other students to get involved. And I partnered with the Ontario ARC, who brought members from not only the Ontario community, but other communities outside of Geneva, with members that attend ARC programs as well as Special Olympics programs. I put together the entire festival based solely off of donations, and I attended 2 meetings, 2 5-minute meetings, where I went to 2 large groups of students and pitched to them my idea of bringing these 2 communities together. Not thinking I would receive so much positive feedback, there were over 100 HWS students alone, both male and female, both athletes, non-athletes, that came and signed up and engaged in this program. So with that background, along with extensive research I've done, I know that people or college students will participate in these programs.
Are there any similar organizations that you've researched that can help you or that you can learn from?
One of the reasons I created Connectable Arts was because there so often there was one program or one event that would happen every couple of years that would bring these 2 communities together. Connectable Arts allows for programs that will be run throughout the entire year. And at the end of the year, there will be a ceremony or a showcase where all the participants in the program will be able to show off their art, music, and dance routines or artwork. So that's what really makes us stand out. There are organizations that serve to the needs of disabilities and are really supportive of normal people connecting with individuals with disabilities, not college students. Connectable Arts stands out because it connects college students with individuals with disability.
First of all, I think it's a commendable cause. It's an amazing thing you're trying to accomplish here. I like your idea of your labor force being college students. You don't think you have a lot of spare time when you're in college. Mm-hmm. Only 20 years later, you realize you've got about 80% of the day free. So I think it's a great thing for college students to get involved
Thank
in.
You.
And your labor is free. And that's a good thing.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
concludes our pitch presentations, won't you all join me and put your hands together for all of our finalists? Okay, at this time, we're going to excuse the judges for your very tough task. If you could follow Susan out, and we'll let you deliberate. For the rest of the audience, you're going to be invited to participate in a dessert reception shortly, but we're going to ask for your help first. Many of you might remember our poll everywhere from last year. As emerging entrepreneurs, our finalists need important feedback from tonight's attendees. We've asked the finalists to submit a question that will provide with essential data as they move forward. Now I'm going to ask you to actually pull out those cell phones that I asked you to put away earlier. We've created an audience poll. The way this will work is we will post each finalist's question during intermission. To respond, you will text to 37607 using your cell phone. For those of you who have a text messaging plan, this is completely free. If you do not have a text messaging plan, we have a laptop in the back which you can use. Those of you at home watching the live feed, you can also vote. Let's try a quick practice question. Do you think we'll have more snow this year? Please text 37607 either yes snow or no snow. Yes snow or no snow must be all one word, no spaces. Responses are not case sensitive. The poll is now open. Okay. Okay, let's close the poll. Okay, looks like we're in for another bit of winter. Okay, so I think you've got it. Our finalist questions will be posted on this slide. You can text to 37607 each time and provide the appropriate yes or no response. For example, to answer Rachel's question, you would text yes out or no out. The Centennial Center for Leadership has also added its own question, and this is open-ended. Down at the bottom, please note before responding to this question, you will need to text to 37607 and type the pitch 2013, all one word, and then text your comment. Responses are totally anonymous. So we will leave our polls open and rotate the questions through intermission. We invite you to respond now as we break. Please don't forget there's a dessert just outside. We'll return in 15 minutes and hear from Sarah Robleski, our last year pitch winner. And afterwards, we'll announce the winner. Thanks very much. We're going to take a few minutes to announce our polls. Thank you all for participating. It very much so helps out our finalists. Okay, let's take a look at our results for Rachel.
All right.
And now Andrew and Zach.
She's got it.
Okay, and now our results for Maddie. Thank you all. We're going to pass these along to the finalists. I want to take a moment. If you look around the room and notice, we had a lot of different needs in terms of setup. We want to thank Michael Hepp and Kathy Williams and all of her crew at Communications, Matt Thomas for doing the live feed back there with the camera, and then our own Morgan Hopkins, the coordinator of leadership programs, has been doing all the tech for the finalists. If you could give them a hand. Okay, we have a special treat. We're going to ask Sarah Robleski, last year's pitch winner, to come up here and give us an update. Woo! Come on up, Sarah, and tell us a little bit more about One Bead.
In the summer of June 2011, a mere college student, found myself at a small school in Nairobi, Kenya. I was surrounded by students who shared only one thing in common with me. their ability to smile and dream big. I was in Africa that summer working at a recycled glassblowing studio. While there, one of my jobs was to develop a fundraiser to help support this local school. From this experience evolved One Bead. One Bead is now a nonprofit organization that strives to elevate education through the sale of handmade, recycled glass beads. The profits from these bead sales are used to fund expensive yet necessary projects in Kenya. That is my story. Now let's help shape theirs. Buy one bead for $12 and provide school supplies for a student. Buy 100 beads and help us install a library. There are countless ways to show your support and become a part of something that is bigger than yourself. One duty, one life, one bead.
Exactly a year ago, my life was changed on this stage when I won $10,000 to expand my organization, One Bead. Thanks to the input and support from so many incredible individuals, I have been able to watch my ideas transform into tangible projects that change people's lives. For those of you who may not know, One Bead is a nonprofit organization whose mission is to elevate education in East Africa through the sale of recycled glass beads. Our long-term goals involve motivating primary school students worldwide through the arts, music, and athletics. After winning the pitch, things started to move quickly, and by the end of May, One Bead finished the construction of our website, www.onebead.org. Since its creation, One Bead has raised over $35,000 in product sales and another $13,000 in grants. In July, One Bead officially announced the release and sale of our One Bead apparel, including t-shirts and tank tops printed with the One Bead logo. We are also working with over 18 representatives on college campuses worldwide. These schools range from the University of East Anglia in Norwich, England, to Villanova University in the United States, and to the University of British Columbia in Canada. In an effort to keep the earnings of One Bead contributing solely to the organization's goals, I applied for and received a Young Memorial Fund grant, which covered the cost of my plane ticket back to Africa this past August. I traveled with three other members of the One Bead team, where we used $6,000 to build a 923-meter fence around the Olo Sirkon Government Primary School. This fence was commissioned primarily in response to acts of thievery and disturbance on the school grounds. It was the first task the community asked for, and likewise, the first major endeavor that One Bead accomplished. In addition, One Bead collected 400 pounds of school supplies, which were donated from supporters in America and distributed to students in late September. At the Olo Sirkon School, we ran a two-day art camp for students that emphasized the importance of recycling and included a trip to the recycled glassblowing studio to see how each bead is made. On August 30th, One Bead became an official tax-exempt 501c3 organization. In October, we collaborated with Grammy-nominated musicians Kinetics and One Love by way of a photo shoot and are currently organizing a benefit concert and art auction with them to be held later this year in New York City. More recently, One Bead has finalized details to begin the construction of a community center outside the Olo Sirkon School. This center will be built on a plot of land officially purchased 2 weeks ago. It will serve not only as a library and study space for students, but as a literacy center for adults, a place that brings experts in to talk about pressing issues, and an exhibition space for local artists. One quote that I constantly refer back to is by social entrepreneur Rye Bearcutt. He says, "Talent is universal, but opportunity is not." The Centennial Center for Leadership and Hobart and William Smith Colleges in general have given us all so many opportunities to pursue and succeed at the things we love. My school has proved themselves countless times to be my biggest supporter. They have gone above and beyond any sort of obligation to make me feel like what I am doing is really important. I know that regardless of how tonight unfolds, The opportunities that you five have ahead of you are endless, and you will always have all of us here to support you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. We would be interested in having you be a judge in a few years. We're really proud of the work you do. Now I want to introduce Susan Pliner, Associate Dean here at the colleges, to announce our winner.
I wish it were as simple as that. I'm not going to announce the winner. I'm going to say a few more words. So first I want to thank Amy and Morgan, the staff of the Centennial Center for Leadership. The 6 months that the Fantastic Five finalists spent with all of us in the Centennial Center for Leadership. And while it was enriching for us and them, it was a great experience. So I wanted to thank Morgan and Amy, particularly for all the work that they do to make this happen. Okay. Okay, so in the fall of 2011, we introduced an assignment within our introductory leadership theory class, HWS Leads, for those that don't know about it, that has become a tradition for the Centennial Center for Leadership. The assignment was an I believe statement that asked students to articulate their values, goals, and beliefs around leadership. The staff at the CCL then authored a We Believe statement in lieu of a traditional mission statement. As we stand today, we believe that leadership can be learned. We believe leadership is a relational process where an individual works with others towards a common goal that benefits the community. We believe in value-based leadership. We believe that ethical leadership is a commitment to difficult conversations. We believe in social justice, equity, and service. We believe in innovation that adds value and intellectual growth. We believe that leaders should have a collective impact. We believe that leadership is striving for positive contributions with significant implications. We believe that reflection is at the core of an effective leader. We believe that engaging within and across difference leads to culturally relevant leadership. We believe leadership is firmly rooted in action. And finally, we believe leadership is a lifelong process of leading self, leading others, and leadership in action. I'm sure you will agree that we witnessed that today with our five finalists. In his TED Talk, How Great Leaders Inspire Action, Simon Sinek talks about the why, the how, and the what. He reminds us that what we do and how we do it are actually less important than why we do it. The why of the Centennial Center for Leadership is to be a catalyst for meaningful change. How we do this is by developing ethical, inclusive, value-based leaders. What we do is provide opportunities like the pitch, which deepens students' learning through applied experiences where great challenge prompts extraordinary effort, growth, and passion. So we're delighted with the results of the second year. And I'd like to thank all the generous supporters and donors of the Centennial Center for Leadership whose gifts have allowed us to do this good work. And now, if I could have all four of the finalists join me on stage. Rachel, Zach, Drew, Maddie, and Mimi, in recognition of your participation in the final round of the pitch, the Centennial Center for Leadership would like to give each of you a certificate. In addition to recognizing your wonderful work over the course of the last few months, we would like to support your continued development towards entrepreneurial leadership. These certificates represent $750 towards an entrepreneurial learning experience, such as a conference or workshop series of your choice. Congratulations on your work to date. Our hope is that the contest has only enhanced your desire to pursue your ideas further. Okay, am I dragging this on too long? Yeah, I know. But it's the only time I get to get up, right? So to announce tonight's winner, of the $10,000 pitch grant, I'd like to invite Judge Sandy Gross to the stage. Sandy is a William Smith alumna, great advocate of the colleges, and a dynamic professional who has been recognized for her own leadership and service in her field, and she's agreed to speak on behalf of our panel of judges.
First of all, I want to thank everyone for inviting me to be a panelist tonight. It's an honor to be up here, and it's a huge responsibility to be a panelist. I have to tell you, I was more nervous, I think, than the finalists. I was very nervous at the very beginning, and I wanted to say one thing that I forgot to say before. And, you know, being an entrepreneur, you have to show tremendous passion and be a great communicator. And all of the finalists, you really exhibited great passion and were fantastic communicators. All of your presentations were tremendous. And we had a very, very hard time picking a winner. We deliberated with great passion amongst all of us. It was really hard. Between the for-profits and the not-for-profits, it was very, very difficult. We were all very passionate, thinking and considering all of you and all of the effort that you put into this. You're all very, very smart. You put a lot of effort into it, and we commend all of you. However, there's only one winner. And we'd like to announce that the winner for tonight for the pitch is Space Vinyl.
Everybody, congratulations to the winners and all the contestants. We thank our judges, we thank the parents, we thank the cheerleading team that was here tonight. It was really heartwarming, and we're glad. It just shows that what we do here has meaning. It was very intriguing to me to see how each of those students interpreted entrepreneurship. It was really an eye-opener. It really shows a truly strong liberal arts background. Thank you, everybody. Have a good night.